I did a lot of damage over the course of my life.
A baseball pitcher with a major league problem.
I certainly felt like I was less than human, and I didn't want to tell anybody.
Welcome to 700 Club Interactive. Today we're going to step into the batter's box against two of the best pitchers in baseball. And they'll tell us why they spent their offseason not on the diamond, but instead thousands of miles away.
We're going to start with the story of R.A. Dickey, the last remaining knuckleballer in the league. Earlier this year, he risked his contract to scale one of the tallest mountains in the world. But that's nothing new for the Mets ace. He's been climbing mountains his entire life.
I could feel its presence like a giant beast lurking in the shadows. Only time will tell if this beast will be friend or foe.
Stretching nearly 20,000 feet into the sky, Kilimanjaro is the highest mountain in Africa and the tallest freestanding mountain in the world. This past January, New York Mets pitcher R.A. Dickey stood at its base and vowed to conquer the beast.
For me, it was tough, you know, and we took a 7-day route, which would help us acclimatize to the conditions as we ascended. But it was still a long walk. I mean, we were walking 7.5, 8 hours a day.
Now, R.A. Dickey wasn't climbing Kilimanjaro because he wanted adventure. He climbed because he wanted to make a difference. In the offseason, he joined Bombay Teen Challenge, a nonprofit dedicated to ending human trafficking.
Well, I have two daughters, ages 10 and 8 years old, and just the thought of them being subjected to the horrors that go on in the brothels of Kamathapura, it almost felt criminal not to do something.
Bombay Teen Challenge provides shelters for former sex workers and HIV-infected orphans. Over the last 20 years, they've helped thousands of children get out of Mumbai's red light district.
I felt like God was really calling me to step out and try to bring awareness to something that sometimes is like a white elephant in the room.
R.A. Dickey blogged about the climb on the New York Times website. But there was one detail he left out of his articles, the one secret he kept hidden from everyone for more than 20 years. As a kid, R.A. Dickey starred in the football, basketball, and baseball teams. He even won a poetry competition. But these weren't activities. They were an escape.
I was always looking for things I could control, and I felt like my life had a lot in it that I could not control. And so I developed mechanisms for dealing with pain and trying to escape it. And, you know, it did a lot of damage over the course of my life. Sports offered me a sanctuary in that regard. It was something that if I put in the time, I could be really good at. And I always found refuge there.
In his book, Wherever I Wind Up, R.A. writes that his mother took him to bars when he was just 5. His parents divorced a few years later. And in the summer of 1983, something happened that would haunt him for the rest of his life.
Well, I was an 8-year-old boy, and I was victimized by a babysitter a few times over the course of the summer, and then again later in the summer as the summer turned to fall by a 17-year-old boy. You know, at that point in your life, when something that dramatic happens to you at that age, you don't have the capacity to put it into words, really. You feel like you've taken part in something so wicked that at some level, it has to be partly your fault. And I certainly felt like I was less than human. And I didn't want to tell anybody about it because I felt like they would just throw their arms up and want to run the other way. And that was a risk I just was unwilling to take.
R.A. spent the next few years of his childhood either running or fighting. When he was a teenager, he moved in with his father, but that didn't change things. Some nights he stayed over at a friend's house. Others, he broke into vacant homes in his neighborhood and slept there.
I would park around the corner and I would hide out, and you know, I had it down. But at least that was a loneliness of my choosing. You know, at least I had control. There was a certain amount of peace I felt in that.
As he got older, R.A. continued to excel in sports. He went to the University of Tennessee and became an academic All-American. In 1996, he won a bronze medal during the Olympic Games and was drafted by the Texas Rangers. The Rangers offered him an $800,000 contract until they noticed his arm was hanging a little funny.
They, at that point, thought there might be something wrong with me. Doug Melvin was the general manager of the Texas Rangers at the time, and he looked across the table and said, you know, we want you to go get a second opinion, but right now we don't even know if we want to draft you. We don't even know if we want to. We're pulling the offer off the table.
After running tests, doctors noticed that he was missing the ulnar collateral ligament in his pitching arm. They said he shouldn't be able to turn a doorknob without pain, let alone throw a baseball.
I thought, this could mean that I'll never get a chance to play professional baseball. So when I sat down across the desk from Doug and he said, I'm sorry, we're taking that away, it was all like my flesh wanted to leap over the desk and strangle him. Like I wanted to cuss him out, I wanted to rage at him, I wanted to be angry at him. But I felt the Holy Spirit say, I've got you. You know, I know it's hard, but I've got you. And because of that, I closed my mouth, I stood up, I shook his hand, and I walked out.
The Rangers slashed their offer by over 90%. Dickey signed anyway. And while he never experienced arm problems, his career was disappointing. He had to make a major change, so his pitching coach suggested he adopt the knuckleball.
Now, the knuckleball is one of the hardest pitches to hit, but it's also one of the hardest pitches to throw. In fact, only a few major leaguers have ever done it effectively. On April 6, 2006, R.A. Dickey wasn't one of them.
1-2, a swing and a long blast to left field. This is another Tiger home run.
In his first and only start for the Rangers that year, R.A. gave up a major league record 6 home runs in one game. He was promptly sent to the minors.
People pretend that they don't hear the crowd, but when you're walking off after an outing like that, you hear every boo, and it's a lonely place. You know, you feel like it's all for nothing.
With his career in shambles and his life still haunted by the abuse, R.A. went to a counselor and decided to reveal everything.
I mean, I was really dealing with things from suicidal thoughts to, you know, any kind of escape I could think of crossed my mind. God used that man to really save my life.
After trying to deal with his pain himself, R.A. asked God for help, and he says God answered.
I felt him saying to me, you've been running and hiding long enough now. I've got something else for you. And so I took a step of faith, and once I took the step to say, you know, I was sexually abused and this is what happened, it was like an enormous, you know, I felt like Atlas, you know, and somebody had just taken the world off my shoulders.
With a renewed focus on life, R.A. continued to play baseball and finally tamed the knuckleball. In 2010, at the age of 35, he joined the New York Mets and posted one of the best ERAs in the league.
I had spent a lifetime trying to control things, people, you know, sports, and it wasn't working. It was crumbling down around me. And God brought me to the place where he said, enough, give it up, you know, surrender it. And the more I trusted God, the bigger he got.
As R.A. Dickey ascended Kilimanjaro, he dealt with hallucinations and shortness of breath. But he wouldn't stop. As a fellow victim of sexual abuse, he knew he had to help.
I thought about, you know, as dark and as cold as I might be, how dark and cold are they in those brothels in the red light districts of Mumbai? And, you know, that really put it in perspective and gave you a little more strength to keep putting one foot in front of the other.
Down below and miles away, the New York Mets were getting ready for another season. Back at home, his wife was caring for the newest addition to the family, their fourth child. Across the world, Bombay Teen Challenge raised more than $100,000 because of the climb. And on a chilly January morning, R.A. Dickey reached the top of the mountain and looked down.
There's been a lot of things, believe me, that haven't gone to script for me that I would, you know, that I would have written out a certain way. But God has had something better. And only in reflection can you really see it, you know, because he's given me not just a second chance, but a third chance and a fourth chance and a fifth chance to infinity, you know, and what a savior, you know, and that's who he is to me. He's a savior, and it's just such a sweet relationship.
He is a savior, and he wants to have a sweet relationship with you. He wants you to know that he's there for you, that he'll guide you. He'll protect you. He'll be your all in all. Now, what does it take to get that? Well, exactly what R.A. went through. It's a process of surrendering. So often when bad things happen to us, we start blaming God. And then we start saying, I'll never, you know, allow anything like that, and I'll take control. And here's what I'll do, and here's the script that I'm going to write for my life. Well, it doesn't work that way. The more we try to control, the less we seem to be able to. And it's only when we surrender to him to say, okay, God, you take me. Now, when you start looking at why do bad things happen, you know, why are children molested? Why does God sit back? And you start that kind of analysis, or you're missing the point. He's given each one of us. He gave that babysitter free will. And he doesn't want to take that back. Did he want that to happen to R.A.? No, he didn't want that to happen. There's a reason Jesus asks us to pray that God's will would be done on earth. Because it's not. His will is not being done. His kingdom is not in charge unless we let him, because he's given each one of us the free will to do things, and sometimes we use that free will to do some very horrible things to one another. How do you find the way back? Just what R.A. did. He finally opened up, and there's a promise that God gives to each one of us that when we do that, he will send messengers after his own heart to guide us. That's what R.A. found. He found a messenger after God's own heart. Now, when you start thinking that way, that God's got messengers for you, then you can open up to them. And what you'll find is God's heart. Now, in God's heart, is he judging you? Is he condemning you? No. He's loving you, he's forgiving you, he's restoring you, he's showing you the way to go. That's God's heart. That's what God wants to do. He's not about to condemn you. If you just turn and come to him, you'll find the forgiveness, you'll find the love that you've been waiting for. And then you'll find that sweet relationship where he guides you, where his still small voice speaks to you and shows you the way to go. If you want this, if you want to take a great adventure with God, all you have to do is ask him. And it's a very simple prayer. Jesus, if you're there, if this is real, if you can really take that hurt away, if you can do that, then I want you. I want you to come into my heart. We've got prayer counselors standing by. All you have to do is call them. 888-777-1999, numbers toll free. And we're not here to judge you. We're not here to condemn you. If there are things that have happened to you that you've never told anyone, you can tell us. You don't have to leave your name. Don't have to give any identifying information. If you just want someone to pray with you and say, okay, I want to have that Jesus. I want to have that relationship. Call us. 888-777-1999. Terry?
Well, you don't have to climb Kilimanjaro to help victims of sexual abuse. Find out how viewers just like you are doing it every day without ever leaving home. And then later on, we're going to hear from another baseball pitcher, the one whose curveball has been called public enemy number one. That's ahead on Interactive.
For the rest of R.A. Dickey's story, read his book. It's called Wherever I Wind Up, which is available nationwide.
It's hard to believe it's been 8 years since I made that commercial. And now I'm a 10-year survivor.
Today's a special day, a big milestone to me. I'm out here riding my horse, appreciating every minute of it.
My life changed the day I was diagnosed with cancer. It was hard when I was lying in the hospital and didn't know if anybody survived pancreatic cancer, but I decided,
if I survive this, I want to offer hope to somebody else
and to show them that there are people out there like Cancer Treatment Centers of America who can make a difference.
To find out more about Cancer Treatment Centers of America and our unique treatment options for complex and late-stage cancer, go to cancercenter.com. You'll be able to see our treatment results for many types of cancers and how they compare to national averages. You can also check for participating insurance plans.
The doctors looked over what they needed to do for me, but the decision was always mine.
At Cancer Treatment Centers of America, every resource, every one of us, everything we do every day is focused on you, our patient, your treatment, your healing, your survival.
After cancer now, I just appreciate life so much more. I appreciate the little things. Being able to carry a bucket of water for my horse again was like winning a marathon. Not 1 hour goes by that I don't stop and think about how fortunate I was to have found CTCA.
Our teams of physicians, clinicians, and nurses are highly experienced and dedicated. We use state-of-the-art technology and give you innovative treatment options you may not even know exist. You'll also experience whole-person compassionate care here, unlike anything you've seen before.
When I talk to people and they said, oh my gosh, a 10-year survivor, I can't believe it. Life is good and I just appreciate it totally. I'm doing things I never dreamt I would do.
Call or go to cancercenter.com today to learn more about our unique approach to state-of-the-art cancer care. Cancer Treatment Centers of America, care that never quits.
Tomorrow on 700 Club Interactive, American Idol's Danny Gokey on his music and his new mission.
We take in homeless families, we rehabilitate their lives, we do music and arts programs with children.
Tomorrow.
Every year in Thailand, thousands of children are abandoned by their parents. Some are even sold into slavery. The 2-year-old in our next story might have been one of them if she hadn't been rescued by Orphan's Promise.
You can probably tell by the smile on her face that 2-year-old Dee Terry is happy to be part of her big new family. She lives here in this children's home in Thailand, sponsored by CBN's Orphan's Promise. In the 2.5 years that she's been here at the children's home, little Dee Terry has received good food and the love of children she now calls brothers and sisters. And this is one of her house parents named Jib. He helps to guide and care for her.
I believe that God brought Dee Terry to us. Whenever I look at her, I am reminded of the grace and love of God.
Now, surrounded by her big family, 2-year-old Dee Terry is thriving. She loves to worship and to raise her little hands in praise to the Lord. And thanks to CBN's Orphan's Promise, Dee Terry will have a safe place to live for as long as she needs it.
Little Dee Terry knows that we love her and that this is her home now. I want to thank you, everyone who has helped us.
So many of you have helped, and we do want to say thank you. You're touching the lives of children and rescuing kids out of really difficult situations, dangerous situations in some cases. We just want to say thank you for caring. If the rest of you would like to be a part of what Orphan's Promise is doing, join with us. We would love to have you join us. We're out to take children who are in broken, desperate situations and bring them to a place of thriving in their lives with the kind of hope in the future that Jesus said he promises us. So help us bring that message. You can see it. Everything that we do to help them physically comes along with the message of God's love. So be a part of that. You can give by calling that number on your screen, 1-888-777-1999, or you can log on to cbn.com. Gordon?
Well, up next, we're going to get a pitching lesson from the reigning National League Cy Young Award winner.
When you get on that mound, your mechanics, your pitches, it's just about competing and getting that batter out. And that's really all that matters.
Find out what matters most off the mound to Dodger Clayton Kershaw coming up.
In an effort to be all-inclusive, one school may have gone too far.
Here you have a top 25 university in the United States that is essentially declaring war on its conservative and orthodox Christian community on campus.
Does this encourage freedom?
I don't mind having a very rigorous conversation.
Or threaten religious liberty?
in trying to combat any possible discrimination, they themselves are actually discriminating against us.
On the 700 Club, next.
If you're the mother of a child with behavior problems, I'd like to talk to you. My name is Janet Lehman, and I'm a behavioral therapist and a mom. I know what it's like when the child that you love becomes a defiant, out-of-control child who disrespects you.
That's why my husband James and I created the Total Transformation, the program that tens of thousands of moms are now using to turn around their child's behavior.
If you've heard about the Total Transformation and wondered if it will work for you, now you can try it for free. I'm willing to give away 1,000 programs today for free.
All you need to do is get the program and let us know how it works for you. We'll let you keep it for free.
I know the Total Transformation works because I used these techniques with my own son and with troubled kids for over 30 years. Let me prove to you that it works by giving you the program free.
Call the number on your screen now to get the Total Transformation free.
Are we all ready, dearly beloved?
I'm responsible for the daily schedule. I write the show copy, I choose the stories that we're going to use, and I also select the guests that are going to come on the show. I get to tell everybody what to do, and I love the sound of my own voice.
And I will sing a song.
I'm here to make sure we speak proper English.
That's the Queen's English. Yeah. I got my knickers in a twist last week. What does the Skype look like, mate?
That'd be great.
Okay, brilliant. We do indeed.
Yeah.
I love being able to pull all the different elements of the show together, and ultimately, making space for God to speak. My name's Sarah. I'm a line producer, and I work at CBN.
Well, it's still early in the season for the boys of summer, but the Los Angeles Dodgers already have a sizable lead in the NL West. Recently, sports reporter Tom Buehring went to the ballpark to talk with their ace pitcher, the left-handed flamethrower, Clayton Kershaw.
I love baseball. I have a huge passion to play the game. I was given a gift to throw a baseball. I didn't do anything to deserve that. I didn't do anything to earn that. I think I'm in the place where I should be right now.
Right now, Clayton Kershaw's place is among the game's elite. He's the reigning Cy Young Award winner after leading the National League in wins, strikeouts, and fewest runs allowed. He's the second youngest player in baseball history to achieve each in the same season. The left-handed flamethrower draws frequent comparisons to another Dodger, Hall of Famer Sandy Koufax.
Best practical advice Sandy Koufax has given to you?
Compete. Just that word, compete. He was so good at it. When you get on that mound, your mechanics, your pitches, it's just about competing and getting that batter out. And that's really all that matters.
To compete, Clayton started throwing with better control of his pitches. The dramatic improvement in Banner's season earned him a new contract extension. Poise and maturity have accelerated his development, but it's the 24-year-old's integrity that's catching league-wide attention.
When you judge a player, think about his character. And with that young man, the character is great, and his ability is great. And that's something special.
It's just, Lord be with me. Winning and losing isn't the most important thing. He's not worried about the outcome of the game. He's worried about how I reflect him and how I'm pitching. I think every time you pitch and every time you go on that mound, you have to understand that it's for him.
When you go pitch to pitch, batter to batter, inning to inning, where do you find your value? Where do you find your worth?
Baseball is so performance-based, and it's what have you done for me lately? And that can get, a lot of pressure. You can feel that. But if your life is given to God and you're into Jesus, there's really no pressure, because at the end of the day, your life's in His control, and you just kind of surrender to that.
It anchored his quick learning curve at a young age, adjusting to the demands of pro baseball as an 18-year-old, and then playing to major league expectations at 20. He found practical help when releasing the daily challenges of his new career.
I was worried about so many different things, anxious about so many different things, and saying, God's only there when I really need Him. But, He's in control of everything, and that's a hard picture for us to grasp, but He's in every aspect of our life, and sooner or later, He'll get in there. It's just a matter of time.
It was just a matter of time before Clayton married his junior high sweetheart, Ellen. Their marriage has also fused a mission of compassion that's become life-changing. Amazing how far a little dirt can go. And in Clayton's case, it combines two of his worlds, the one right here that's quickly emerging as his platform, and the other as a reminder, a half a world away on the back dirt roads in Africa. Where Clayton has come alongside Ellen's work with orphans in Zambia. The couple detail their trips in their book, Arise. Clayton's donating $100 for every strikeout he throws this season.
Strikeout number 11. Talk about put a ribbon on the package.
He gave me baseball. He gave her Africa. And so when I go over there with her, I just see her in her element. And, you know, it's given me just a huge perspective on life. And, you know, you go over there and you see the kids and you see how joyful the people are over there. You know, two dirts, one passion, but it's pretty special.
The Dodgers pitching ace calls baseball a stage, giving him room to make a meaningful pitch.
There's got to be more to going to your 9-to-5 job every day or coming to the baseball field every day. There's got to be more to it. There's got to be purpose. There's got to be a reason that we're here, and it's for the glory of God. And I think until you kind of grasp that and understand that this life is a gift and that the only reason we're here is because he wants us to be, and living out his faith, living out our faith in him.
Boy, Clayton's got it together, doesn't he? Well, you can read more about Clayton Kershaw and his work with orphans in the book that he wrote with his wife, Ellen. The book is called Arise, and you can find it all across the country wherever books are sold.
Well, this is 700 Club Interactive, and this is the time where we turn the show over to you, our audience. So if you want to be a part of the program, just go to our website, 700clubinteractive.com. You can also go to our Facebook page. Or you can send us a tweet at 7C Interactive. Let's go over to Craig Von Busick for our first question.
Gordon Gary writes in and says, I have been suffering from a serious sciatica problem. I ask God to take the pain away, but I'm still suffering with it. Why? Am I doing something wrong? I feel like God has turned a deaf ear to me.
A lot of people in praying for healing get sidetracked into, am I doing something wrong? Am I doing something right? And you start looking for what's the formula. And I would encourage you, don't do that. Don't start thinking, do I have enough faith? Because that'll just get you in a very negative frame of mind. Don't start thinking that God's turned a deaf ear to you. There's the word of the Lord from the Apostle John. We have this confidence. If we pray in accordance with his will, we know that he hears us, and if he hears us, we know that we have what we request. So, is it God's will to heal the sick? Get that first straight, and it's very clear from the Word of God. It is his will. You know, Jesus went around doing good, and he destroyed all the works of the enemy. He went around healing the sick. He went around taking back people from the kingdom of darkness and bringing them into the kingdom of light. That's what he does. And the promise is he forgives all your iniquities. He heals all your diseases. So if you're praying in accordance with his will, and his will is to heal the sick, that's what Jesus did, then you know that he hears you. So now he's not deaf. You don't have to talk him into it. You do need to realize it's already happened. When were your sins forgiven? Well, they were forgiven on the cross. Were your diseases healed? Well, they were forgiven on the cross. They were healed on the cross. And when you get that doctrine straight, it really gives you a whole lot of confidence in your prayer. Now the issue is, are you going to persevere? And Jesus said, and he gave us lots of parables about praying. He gave us the parable of the unrighteous judge and how it took knocking on the door. That's why he told us, seek and keep on seeking. And these are active verbs in the Greek language where it's a continual seeking. If you seek and keep on seeking, you will find. So just keep at it and keep looking to him. He's the author and the finisher of your faith. You don't have to come up with a faith. He gives it to you. Just look to him. Look at the great facts that have already been accomplished. Then you get it. And then you get all the faith that you could ever want because Jesus gives it to you and the Holy Spirit gives himself to you without measure. So that's a very long answer to a short question, but it's one that I really think will help people. Well, that's all the time we have for today's show. We leave you these words from Isaiah. But those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. God bless you.